evening, everyone. My name is Jody Monroe. I'm the superintendent of schools here at Bethlehem. Thanks for coming out this evening. Tonight, the agenda really is to talk a little bit about the options for Clarksville. Hopefully you've had a chance to read some of the information that was either mailed to you, has been in the newspaper, or is on our website. Hopefully we'll try to cover most of that and then some additional information. We have representatives from the Sheriff's Office. Sheriff Apple is here with many members of his team. We also have Board of Education members and our administrative team. So between all of us, I'm hoping that we can answer all your questions, or if we can't answer them tonight, follow up with questions that you might have. So I do want to introduce our board members who are here this evening. Dr. Charmaine Wintersinger just walked in from the track banquet, I assume.
Going back and forth.
Mr. Matt Downey, our president of the board. Ms. Lynn Lenhart, our vice president of the board. Jonathan Fishbein, board member. And Michael Cooper, board member. Joanne Cunningham was not able to be here this evening. So I'm going to begin the presentation. And again, a little delay there. We do plan to cover these areas tonight. We're going to talk about some of our enrollment projections, fiscal overview, some of the maintenance costs, legal requirements, the school's history, and some of the next steps, and hopefully answer your questions that you may have for us. So in the fall, we were approached by the Sheriff's Office, who had indicated an interest in purchasing Clarksville. They've been leasing the building for a number of years and want to make it permanent. At that time, we were in the midst of getting a demographic study from the Capital Region Planning Commission, and that report is actually on our website if any of you are interested, because we wanted to look at what our enrollment trends looked like for the next few years and further out. We also wanted to find out what the development looked like for the future of the school district as well. So that began some of the information that we've since sent out in regards to the shared interest, some of the information that you've all seen, some of the information that's on our website leading up to this evening. So currently, the sheriff has been the tenant since August 2012. The current lease terms are $54,000 a year, plus they do in-kind security patrols after Memorial Day through the end of the school year, particularly at the high school. The county pays all the operating costs of the building. The district maintains the building systems, such as the boilers and things such as that. And at the lease end, the agreement is that the property would be restored to the pre-rental condition, obviously less this normal wear and tear on any building. If purchased by the Albany County Sheriffs, and they can certainly speak a little bit more to this, the building would operate as an emergency shelter. It would also be a community resource. The plan is to keep the playground area. It would remain available for activities such as karate, Boy Scouts, some basketball is up there currently. They would certainly be a neighborhood presence, as they've been, and they would look to bring in additional support services that are available. It would not become, I know we've received a few emails inquiring about this, and I don't know if the sheriff has a concern if that will actually become a jail. It will not become a holding facility or a jail, and there would be a plan to add a one-story, about 40 by 40 garage for vehicle storage in the future. As I mentioned before, we did have an enrollment study done, or demographic study, by the Capital Region Planning Commission. That was presented to the board on December 7th. We had updated residential development information that was presented on February 1st, which the town provided in regards to some of the development that's slated for the Bethlehem School District. So some of the new housing, which is in the report, you can see these are the number of single-family residential areas that are expected to potentially impact the school district. You can see that the development will be relatively slow. Many of these have not started. Some are just beginning. So you're looking at anywhere from 10 to 20 per year of new housing. Much of the new housing that's being proposed is multifamily residential, which in speaking with the town is not slated to attract necessarily families with children who would be attending the Bethlehem schools. The enrollment projections. You can see that the enrollment has been on a downward trend for several years now. Looking out from this year, our current enrollment is 4,591 K-12. Looking out to 2021-22, that enrollment is expected to continue to decline to just under 4,200 K-12. We also currently do have, one of the questions was if we have capacity in other buildings. In regards to on the schools where it shows available sections, those sections mean there's available classroom space in each of those buildings. It doesn't address necessarily the capacity in other sections. So for example, if a kindergarten class is currently at 17, they still have capacity to add more students in those particular classrooms up till whatever we try and stay within a cap of about 21. But those are actually empty classrooms in those three buildings currently. So what if the projections are wrong? Obviously, we can do our best to figure that out. But there are things that obviously you can't necessarily predict. For example, if a lot of housing turns over quickly and many families with small children do move in, that would be an impact. If the development happened a little bit quicker than expected, there could be some impact as well. There are no plans currently for new development in the town of New Scotland. The mandatory staffing levels at a separate building also add significant costs. So for example, one of the questions, what happens if you reopen Clarksville? Currently today, to reopen the building with staffing levels and maintenance to upgrade systems that would need to be done would be about $900,000 to reopen, and then obviously you have the annual cost with running a building. We would have to do some upgrades that have been done in our other schools. For example, we've upgraded much of the technology that has not been done at Clarksville, so that would require some additional investment. At this time, I'm going to turn it over to Judy Kehoe. She's our Chief Financial Officer, and she's going to talk to you a little bit about the budget and the fiscal overview of the Clarksville School.
Good evening, everybody. We want to make sure that you have all the information that is relevant relative to the financing or the finances for the Clarksville building. The building has been assessed at $1.7 million for a number of years now, and we knew that the assessed value was not necessarily the market value. So what we did was we hired a licensed appraiser, and we had an appraisal completed. And that just came back, and that was showing a value of $410,000. The county also had a separate appraisal done, and their appraisal was in the ballpark of this number as well. It was a little bit higher, but nowhere near the $1.7 million that the property is assessed at. And some of the things that they had highlighted in that report had to do with the age and the condition of the building, but they also noted that as a school, there's a relatively limited buyer's market for the property. And some of the things that they noted for other schools in the area that were on the market, they were seeing uses such as either a residential conversion. We noted here Shalmont was a building that sold that was to be used for residences. Burnt Hills, Boston Lake was going to be used as a private school. The appraisal noted that it would typically be for those types of uses or for other municipal uses. It does tend to lend itself as offices, and certainly I know with the sheriff's team being in there for the last 5 years, it seems to have met their needs as well. The other thing that was noted and that was part of that value is the length of time that properties are listed. that they sit on the market, and some of them were upwards of 2 years and closer to 3 years. And what the other schools who were selling the buildings were seeing is they started out, say, over $1 million, and then gradually, as that length of time continued, the asking price or the selling price ultimately was lowered down to about the same dollar per square foot that is reflected within the appraisal that we had received. They also had noted that while the Clarksville Elementary School is designated with historic value, that could cause some additional concerns if it were to be sold, only because that creates other limitations on what can be done with the building going forward. So that was the highlight of what was cited as the reasons why the appraised value was substantially below the assessment. We do still have bonds outstanding on Clarksville. We had a significant amount of work done back in 2003. It was about $4 million worth of work, and that was when the cafetorium was added, and the offices in the front, and then some other upgrades in the building. Because those are municipal bonds, once they are issued, you can't pay them off early. You're locked in through the maturity date, which is June of 2022. So we have about $1.7 million in bonding still outstanding based on that work that was done back in 2003. So because of that, if the building were to be sold, any of the sales proceeds would be restricted. So it's not money that's going to come into the general fund to be used for other purposes. It would go into what's called a mandatory reserve, exactly like what we did when 90 Adams had been sold. Those proceeds, because there was debt outstanding on that, are sitting in a mandatory reserve, and then a little bit of that gets drawn down each year to give a little bit of relief into the budget and offset those debt service costs. The district is still receiving state building aid based on that work. We get about 68% of the debt service amounts in the form of building aid. What happens if you sell a school building that has building aid still flowing is they do an offset. So whatever the amount of the sales proceeds are, that reduces the amount of state aid that would flow to the district. So essentially it would be a wash in terms of our net position from now until 2022, 5 years out when that debt is paid off. One of the factors that we're looking at is knowing that the sheriff would like to be able to make improvements to the building so it better suits their needs. Under the terms of the lease, anything that they do to the building has to be undone if they move out of the building. And that was a very important term of the lease when we first entered into that, because 6 years ago when we closed it, we talked extensively about, well, what happens if we're doing this because we have some significant, we and every other district in New York State have some significant fiscal pressures. What if the tide turns and we want to be able to reopen? We needed to have that clause in the lease. In order to have a continued lease, though, we need to have a willing tenant. So if we now have interest from the sheriff to purchase the building, in order to make the improvements that they need to more efficiently run their operations, if we choose not to sell, we risk losing the sheriff's office as a tenant. And we don't have any other prospects at the moment. Again, it's kind of a specialty use thing. So if it's a vacant building, there are certainly neighborhood impacts that come from that. When we had closed it initially, that was one of the concerns we had. And if a building is unattended, you also increase your risk of vandalism to the property, which we would not want to see either. If the building is vacated, not only does it mean that that stream of rental payments stops coming into the district, it means that we would then need to incur additional costs in order to maintain the building. So obviously you would need to heat it to a certain temperature to make sure that you don't have freezing pipes going on in wintertime or cold weather. We would need to be maintaining the alarm systems so that we could be alerted to intrusions or other problems in the building. And other repairs, obviously, you don't want to be letting the roof deteriorate so that you would have leakage or other types of damage that that would cause. So the estimate is about $26,000 a year in carrying costs just to maintain that building. We would still be paying insurance on the building, about $5,000 a year. And then absent the lease agreement, the district would need to go back and pay for those security details that occur between Memorial Day and the end of school. Additionally, the concerns are the five-year facilities plan had identified work that would need to be done at some point in the future, and that was about $2.1 million of roofing and envelope type work, masonry and concrete repair and things like that that would be wearing down over time. So if the enrollment demographics indicated that there would be an increase in students and that we would indeed foresee a need to reopen the building, then it would absolutely make sense to incur those carrying costs in order to maintain the building, because that becomes your safety net, your ability to reopen at that point. But based on the numbers that we're seeing for enrollment, we do not see a future need to reopen that. As Ms. Monroe had mentioned, there's also significant operating costs to reopen it again as a separately standing school. So with a limited tenant pool, we do have a willing or an interested purchaser. Based on that timing, it does appear that it could be an opportunity to maintain that presence from the sheriff within the community and allow the district to avoid those future costs for maintaining the building. Okay. Procedurally, if the decision was made that we were interested in selling the building to the sheriffs, the Board of Education would need to take action to declare that the district no longer has use for the building as an elementary school. The sales price would have to be determined to be reasonable, essentially at market. And there is no requirement to hold a vote. So on the May vote, it would not have to appear as a ballot item. It would be something that's known as a permissive referendum. Upon vote by the board, if the community then wished to have that be considered on the ballot, there would need to be a petition with 10% of the qualified voters or more signing that they wanted to see that on the ballot. At the county level, they have a public safety committee that would need to review the proposed sale or purchase for them and then ultimately approve that as well. There is a lot of treasured history as part of the Clarksville building. I know many of you have attended there yourselves, your children have attended there. Walking through the building, you see those years of memories and treasured items from the artwork that's around the building. There's plaques, there's murals. We've worked with Melanie Painter to explore how might we best preserve that. Some of the artwork is on plaster, so you can't remove it and still preserve it. So what we'd like to propose if we do this is to actually digitally reproduce. So you take a high quality photo and then you could put that on essentially a poster that's a nice quality that would allow you then to preserve that work that was done. There is the peace pole, there's the sign for the building for Clarksville Elementary. We would envision that we could set up perhaps a special area at Slingerland's in a nice garden area where that could be identified as a place to... location to be determined. Or it could stay at Clarksville. There's a beautiful bronze plaque on the building now that Mr. and Mrs. Petruska had donated, and that is something that would stay on the building to commemorate the years that the building had been used as an elementary school. So those are just some of the thoughts that we had on how we might be able to preserve those items. So that, I hope we've answered all the questions, or at least the majority of the questions that had been submitted or that we might have anticipated. But this is the meeting where we really had hoped to have your questions and your feedback and hear how things are going at this point. So what we would ask is, so everybody can hear you, please do come up and use the microphone if you have a question or a comment. And
Good evening, first of all. Thank you. We weren't sure what kind of turnout we were going to get, but it's nice to see everybody come out, whether you're pro or con. We appreciate your participation in it. We've been in there, as Jody said, we've been in there for 5 years. We try to be good neighbors out there. We're kind of in a little bit of a state of flux right now where do we stay? Do we build somewhere? That area is particularly good for us. We're right on 443. We can get anywhere we need to go. Relatively quickly. We're only a couple miles away by way profiles from our old station, which is obviously much smaller. As far as modifications, my vision is to kind of keep the building in its current state of form, really, with the exception of inside, making some of the classrooms a little bit smaller, more efficient, things like that. Obviously, there's a lot of updating. The building's not in the greatest shape. The building needs a lot of work. There's some abatement that needs to take place in there. Some of the windows are rotting out. It needs a lot of work. But it's probably not the best financial move that we could make, but I think it's the best move for what we want to do in the community and to be a good neighbor and to open up resources in the community. The gymnasium, the cafetorium, it's great to see the public come out and use that. The playground is definitely staying. That was never even a thought to move. That's going to stay there. We want the kids to come. What better place to go than to the police station? It's great to see. We teach karate in the gymnasium. We have softball teams that come in. We have Boy Scouts that come in and use it. Many of you know that we do the Hilltown Christmas. In December, we'll have 300 kids and families in there, and that gymnasium will be packed with toys. So the building, it has a lot of really good usages for us. And again, my big dream would be to make the police station kind of have half of it, maybe a little bit more than half of it. I'm still not sure how big the place is because I've been told it's 32,000, 35,000, 38,000. So, you know, when you start jumping up by the thousands, those are big rooms. We do not occupy four of the rooms currently, which I know is around 750 to 980 square foot a room. So we're not utilizing all of it anyway at this point. And the rooms that we are using, honestly, are we're using just grossly inefficiently because they're so large. We may have two people in one, and so it's, you know, we can do a lot better with it. But listen, as far as plaques, peace poles, things of that nature, I would love to see it stay. I envision leaving Clifford the Big Red Dog on the wall. I want to keep Clifford. I think that's the most awesome thing you can see when the kids come into the building. You know, they naturally, it settles them a little bit. I have no problem with that. A couple of them are going. But Clifford's staying. But there's a lot of, I think there's a lot of really good things we can do out there. As I started to say, my vision would be to kind of make, you know, 40, 50, maybe 60% of it an actual police station. And then in the front part of it, if we could, if we can come up with the funding necessary, I'd like to see some of the resources that the county offers to come out. A lot of people up on the mountain don't like to go down to the city. And so needless to say, to go without the services. So I'd like to see the services come out a little bit closer to them. And I think maybe we'll be able to help a lot of people with a much better life if that's our goal. So that's really where we're at. We're like in the super infant stages. This, you know, I went to them. They didn't say, hey, we want to sell the school. We kind of put pressure on them that, hey, we want to buy the school. And I just think it really will serve our purpose. I think it will serve the communities out there that that we primarily police for. And again, we're not too far out from Bethlehem where we want people to come out there. We want people to utilize the gymnasium, utilize the cafeteria, and we envision getting the kitchen back up. It is, in fact, right now, the county emergency management center. I mean, we have made some modifications, basically just to harden it up a little bit, to harden it as far as we put fencing up, we put a generator out there, we ran a lot of fiber out to it, and increased the technology accessibility for the building. But other than that, we really haven't done anything. We'll put some carpet down in a couple rooms and clean them up a little bit. So, but it does need a lot of work. I think it's a diamond in the rough. I think it's in a perfect place for the community. We do run our ambulances out of there currently. We run the emergency management out of there, investigators out of there, patrol out of there, and again, a lot of the community things that we do. But we really are in a little bit of state of flux as far as, you know, we're slowly taking over an ambulance building. So our EMS may migrate down to that entire building, which will also open up a little bit more space. So the sky's the limit as far as thinking and having a vision. But we really want, you know, we want to be good neighbors, and that's why it was important for the school. It was important for us to meet with everybody as we did 5 years ago when we talked about taking it over. And it would be a shame to see it sit if we can't work something out. I honestly don't know who would go in there. It is big, but it would be a shame, really a shame to see it sit, because, you know, year one is pretty much just dust balls blowing around. Year two would be dust balls and graffiti, and year three, so on and so on. Eventually the people are back on the roof and the graffiti and arson or whatever. So that's pretty much where we're at. I will say the 40 by 40 building is a thought that we want to do. Could be a little bit bigger, could be a little bit smaller. It's not going to be a sky rise high rise or anything like that. It's just going to be basically like a Morgan building where we can put some of our larger pieces of equipment that we have currently all over the county, primarily at the airport. But we want to kind of bring everything back home.
What's going to happen to the woods behind the school? Is that part of your projected sale property?
Yes.
Yeah, that's part of that. That's in the appraisal. The land and the building itself is all part of the appraisal.
Is it going to stay woods?
Yeah, we don't really have, it's not as big as we thought back there. And I know there's a lot of wetlands in those woods anyway. And currently they're carved out of our lease, primarily because there were wetlands and we didn't want to be responsible for it. But yeah, it would be all of it. And we would have no, really, we just need a little bit of that field for the garage. But we want to make those fields actually back to playing fields, because we do sponsor a lot of kids' lacrosse, soccer, karate, flag football. So I'd like to see the kids come out. Right now out there for the Hilltown kids, it's mostly karate, and obviously we can do it indoors. But as it gets a little nicer out, we'd like to see the kids out here get involved in lacrosse, specifically out in the mountain that don't really have the accessibility to that. Get involved in our lacrosse programs, our flag football programs, things of that nature.
Thank you. So what we're going to do is we do want to give everyone a chance to ask any additional questions or express anything you'd like to share, and all of us, hopefully between all of us who are here, we can answer those questions for you this evening. I think that Clifford might need a little touch up in some areas, so yeah. So what I'd ask you to do, if you do have questions or comments, if we have a couple, we have a mic here, we can use this mic. If you can come up, state your name, and ask what your question is or comment, and we will try best to answer them. So I'll open it up to the community at this point.
You can just lift the mic right out.
Yeah, it pops right out.
So you don't have to bend over.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Andy Lee. I live here in Del Mar. I think part of what I feel in terms of sensitivity to this issue is that the board, before Eagle was built, did some really bad projections, and that is how we end up here. And so I want to know what those numbers are based on, if they're based on, you know, actuarial building that is projected by building companies, by, you know, people like Clercy and those guys. Have you been able to vet through them what their projections are, what their land ownership is, and whether we can make a prediction with a little more accuracy, because we did a poor job, I think. And, you know, Eagle's a lovely school. My kid went through Eagle. I'm not complaining. I'm just saying that the way it played out was very, very expensive, and at the cost of a lot of kids who now have to travel a long distance to Eagle to be able to attend public school.
So this was the first year that we contracted with Capital Region Planning Commission. Several schools in the area have used them for their enrollment projections for a number of years, and found them to be fairly accurate. They use things such as live birth data, census data. They use the town's information for potential development that is occurring now and in the future to look at how many households will be built in this number of years that will have potentially children in it. The one factor that I mentioned earlier that you can't always project is movement into the district, potentially when houses turn over and the types of families who move into those homes with children are a little bit of an unknown. But if you look at our enrollment projections for in the last 6 years, and not just in Bethlehem, across many of the suburban districts, the enrollment has declined, and we've seen it most dramatically in our elementary schools, and that is the trend is continuing to our middle school and high school. Based on those enrollment projections right now, it looks as if there'll be slight decline still next year in the elementary level, and then the projections are for that to level off. For the numbers to go back up to where they were 10 years ago, which we were over 5,000, I think would take many years to get back to that point, because we're not seeing the number of families with the number of children. Even when the houses are turning over, they don't have as many children as they do.
A lot of baby boomers are aging out of these bigger houses. Mm-hmm. So in the next 10 years, you're going to go from, you know, having people in their late 50s to mid 60s. Mm-hmm.
Sure.
That's a lot. That's a big group, right? Mm-hmm. That's a big population.
Right, sure. It's a valid point.
So is the answer no on the, like, Hannafin and Quercy and, like, finding out how much property they own that they're planning to build on in that area?
The town planning board, we did involve them in the report with the Capital Region Planning Commission. They were the ones who actually provided us with the updates on those slides that I showed on the different developments about more accurate time frames for when those houses would develop. Sorry.
Hi. I was wondering, Sheriff Apple, if you have worked preliminarily with social services and are they interested in moving some services into the building, such as maybe Medicaid applications, food stamp applications? I live in Clarksville. I grew up in the Hilltowns, have a lot of ties there. I know that people from the Hilltowns, and I also worked in social services, so I know what the social services department downtown is like. I know the people in the Hilltowns, and I know that would be a real benefit for people in the Hilltowns to have, you know, a resource locally that they could go to, because they won't go downtown. So I just wondered if you've gotten support from the Social Services Department to put some services there.
Honestly, because we're in such, again, infancy stages of this, I haven't, you know, really prodded anybody. I had a quick conversation with the county executive. All of the town leaders support us. Hilltown leaders support this. I'm sure that kind of go with it, if you build it, they will come theory. And trust me, I'm going to do everything I can do to get them out there, not just social services, but CPS. And I'd like to see probation have a satellite there. I'd like to even see the district, well, the district attorney kind of comes out now before it anyway. But, you know, look, we deal with the residents in this area every single day. We know what it's like to get stuck in that cycle of poverty. We know exactly what's going on. And I know that if they had some access, there's a good shot that we can break that cycle and maybe save some kids. And that's what we're trying to do.
Thank you.
Okay, I know the police are here. We'll be okay.
Hi, I'm not this short.
Just take the mic out, Judy.
Oh, okay.
All right, but now I can't hold my notes.
Let me,
I'm not good at public speaking.
Anyway.
All right, I'll sing for you all now.
What do you do with that?
Yeah, good. I'm not really a microphone person.
Well,
okay.
Now's your chance.
Yep. So I managed not to drop my notes, so I should be okay. So I listened to your presentation. I did a lot of, my name's Judy Abbott. I did a lot of research before I came to this meeting. And I saw some different numbers, so I was a little bit confused by some of those that I saw here. And certainly I don't have the glass half empty as the presentation I heard tonight. I have a, wait a minute, let's slow down here approach to this, because I see different numbers. So let me start with my notes, my little talk. I want to thank you for allowing us to have this opportunity to talk to you guys, the school board, the administration. You guys are making this decision. Thank you, Sheriff Apple, and all of your coworkers, and you guys, you know, really do a lot of work for the county, and I really appreciate that. And I hope that we still see you in our community. I'm not against that, okay? But this board really does have before you guys a really important decision that will forever affect Clarksville and that will forever affect this district. And, you know, I really want you to be mindful that you, of your fiduciary, I know you always are, but your fiduciary responsibility, short-term and long-term, your responsibilities to all taxpayers. We do have another side of the New Scotland Town border that are often, well, certainly we're not represented on the school board. Not one of you live in Clarksville community. I definitely want to make sure that's a public known. So, but I'm glad to see people are here, you know, despite, I'm skipping around. I think a poor outreach, and I will get to that in a minute. You guys know I love my community. I love my school district. I do a lot for my kids' school classes and teams, and, you know, but you guys really do have a lot of power here. So I really would hope that you're going to be thoughtful and deliberate about your decisions here and not to flip. I was certainly disappointed from day one when we learned that this meeting, when I got the SNN, I learned about this meeting was coming up. I said, how are you guys getting the word out here? Because not many people subscribe to school news notifiers. My neighbors didn't know about it. Their kids have gone through Bethlehem already, and some of them are ready to downsize and flip. They're houses, not decisions. So, you know, tonight is a really busy night in both the town of New Scotland and the town of Bethlehem. As you know, every first Wednesday of every month is that both towns have their board meetings, so that prevents my superintendent from being here or others. Actually, I wanted to be at our town board meeting, but I also wanted to be at my daughter got MVP tonight, that's why I ran out. So, you know, there was two public hearings on local laws. You know, my volunteer fire department has their president's meeting tonight. You know, there's so much going on tonight. And when I learned that was only used by SNN was the only way that we got the word out, I said, can't we do something else? And I called, and I thank you guys for putting flyers in the P.O. boxes at Clarksville. However, the P.O. boxes only affect a small portion of that side of the uphill area. You completely forgot about the south side of 443, which is served by Feuerbusch zip codes. You completely forgot about 12054, which I am and my neighbors are, and we go all the way up to Verde Lane. And you also forgot about the Voorheesville zip code. So, and I did a little test. I called my friends, my doctor's office, where I know the administrative staff will live up in Clarksville, and they said they had no idea about this meeting. So a lot of people really don't know about it. So I've got to tell you, people just don't have kids in the school district whose property values are affected by this decision, they don't go visit Bethlehem's website all the time, all right? So that's just something I want to make sure, you know, and actually one thing I asked immediately was, could you guys please get the word out by your tax rolls? You know, use your tax roll address to get the word out. You send bills every year. I didn't know why you couldn't have got the word out that way. And they told me you couldn't do it, so I don't know about that. But anyway, I was disappointed with that. But I really hope that you give it a lot of decision, a lot of thought, rather, because you do have some long-term repercussions about losing Clarksville. You do lose your flexibility. I don't see, well, I'm not gonna jump too much. You're going to lose flexibility in addressing any changes in enrollment if you do have an increase in enrollment in the future. And, you know, I've been saying this for 5 years, 6 years, and 5 years. I think it's really unfair that you expect the kids, the elementary level kids in the Clarksville community and the surrounding area, they're the only ones in your district that have an hour, up to an hour, and some kids have more, even though your board meeting, they said largest was 55 minutes. I know some kids that have an hour and 15 minute bus rides, and that they've had that since kindergarten. That is a complete unfortunate situation, and I really think it's an unequal. I don't know anyone in the town of Bethlehem side that has that long bus ride, and these are little kids, all right? It's just not fair to little kids to have 2 hours a day on a school bus, okay? And that's one of the things I really want you to think about, because you'll be basically making that situation last forever, all right? I will also say, I believe geographically, Clarksville is located in a good location in that rural, it's a very large rural area. It's 22 and a half square miles, okay? And the property was practically given to the school district. It was sold for a dollar by George Teerling, 12.4 acres, that's a lot of land. And my coworker's father donated all the sand and gravel to make the mortar to build the school. So it truly was a community building or community school. And it's, again, you guys already mentioned, it is on the National Register of Historic Sites. And you didn't mention why. It was the first public school building that was built for to abandon the traditional institutional designs, and it was built for handicap access, all access, and it was built with pre-LEED, you know, passive ventilation and the use of natural lighting and the orientation. I know the people that were involved with getting this on the list. It's you guys ought to be proud of the building. I'm kind of sad that some of you haven't even been there, perhaps. Last I knew, you weren't. And it was designed by a famous architect called named Henry Blaettner. So I think you guys want to have a little more pride in the school building, frankly. My real biggest worry, and I didn't see your enrollment, I don't believe enrollment models, number one. I studied the math that went into those models. We have made many decisions in the school district that were, frankly, wrong based on those models. I'm off my notes. I attended the meetings with Les Loomis when they were talking about building Eagle, and you guys were talking about enrollment projections going out the roof. You know, they're coming, they're building and building. Well, the Little League folks that actually did the registration, and there was a lot of hand registration now, not so electronic online, they sat there and stood up and said, no, our is going down. We don't need this building. It's going down because they had the real enrollment. They had the pre-K kids coming into Little League, and they showed with a graph to Les Loomis that enrollment was going down. And that was a result of the building moratorium in Pound Bethlehem. Was that 2003, 2002, something like that? I don't live in the town, I'm not sure. But when I read your December 2016, was it long range planning report? I forgot. I read too many reports. It talked about 766 residential units coming online and that are already signed off on, 766. That wasn't the number I saw, so I'm a little bit concerned about that. And I know and my husband, who's at the track banquet over here, we certainly would be upset as taxpayers if we're asked to pay for additions on Glenmont in 5 years. I don't think Slingerlands can expand, and you're gonna have a lot of growth in Slingerlands, especially since we have Vista coming. Businesses and development attract growth and the competitiveness of the school. And this school district is a great school district. So you're always gonna attract families. I disagree with this long-standing argument that apartments don't yield children. They do. My coworkers live in apartments here and they have kids. I know I live near mansions. There's like a little cabbage patch farm sometimes there. You know, I mean, I disagree with that urban myth that keeps being perpetuated. And I want to make that really clear. And also with the declining enrollment thing, our comptroller just came out with a report talking about the state of the schools and regional school districts all of the regional school districts experienced a decline in enrollment in the last 6-7 years. They all did. It's economics, okay? Recessions, contractions, people don't have kids, you know, they lose their jobs, you know, it's economics. But I know when I study some of these school districts and our suburban competitors, and I forgot my water and I'm nervous, they're all seeing upticks in kindergarten, and so are we. We're seeing upticks in kindergarten enrollment. I read that in the report. There's a little uptick.
Uptick for projected for next year, but it's down still this year, the kindergarten.
Okay, but it's coming back, is all I'm saying. There was an inflection point,
Yeah. Okay?
All the other schools are seeing it too. North Colony, Voorheesville. Voorheesville is actually having a huge development boom. So, you know, I'm just kind of worried that if even a third, like I said, I have a different vision of how you guys paint your picture. You know, even if a third of these kids, of these 766 residential units bring children in the elementary level, you might need Clarksville. Because there really isn't that much space, as you know, in your other buildings. Slingerland's, what are they gonna lose, the music room, if you're gonna have more kids coming in? Really, is that, you think people are gonna be happy about that? I don't think they would be. So I do wanna talk about enrollment projections. The math is so simple. All it does is look a little bit in your past and carry that line forward. It's just drawing a line forward. And the actual original paper, you've probably heard me say this, from 1970, that all these models are based on, the guy says, Webster says in that paper, only use this math, this algorithm, when it's stable. Stable enrollment. Don't use it for inclines, don't use it for declines, because you'll get an error in your result. That's what the paper actually says. I could probably dig it up. I have a file this thick. So what I'm saying there is I really hope that you guys don't make any big decisions based on enrollment model projections. I've seen it before. It doesn't work out for the entire school district. You know, basically all that's doing is carrying that line. If the line's going down, the models are just gonna bring it down. What's probably more important by doing some research is economics factors, business factors, and development factors. So look around you. Don't rely strictly on these enrollment models. Look around you, what's going on in your community, and think. Think long-term. Just don't think about your current terms on the board. So, you know, I did notice that the selling of Clarksville to the sheriff doesn't really offer much fiscal gain to the district. I know that the New York State law requires you to report the amount that you receive. General Municipal Law 6L that reports it to SED. You got to hold on to it, like you said. And since we're still paying on debt on that from our capital improvement, which was a lot of money, so I'm really shocked that that's all the building is worth. And I remember the project including upgrades to all the tech. I do remember that. I probably have information on the bond too, but I'm sure your O&M people can bring it forward. You know, so basically, I talked to State Ed. I said, what does this mean? And they said, well, it could mean that you got to report it, and you probably might use some of the money to pay down your debt, you know, so whatever small amount we get from building it, the building, you got to pay some of that debt down, but it probably also would affect your state aid in the future, is what they said. It might, that's what they told me, it could lower state aid in the future. You're nodding, so you must have heard. It's in that memo. It's a need base.
It lowers your building aid offset by the sales price.
Yeah, yeah. So I don't really feel like there's a big advantage financially, you know, but I really want to make sure that, I guess I didn't know that we had to petition to get this on a ballot. I thought maybe it automatically went on a ballot. But I would like, I guess I was hoping that you make sure that your community really, really understands what that means. Because when I was talking to people about, because I don't speak for everybody, I don't feel like I do. When I was reading and talking to people, they were like, oh, good, we'll get some money, you know, get some new source of income. That's not what it means. So the word sell is a little misleading. So I just want to make sure you really do a good job articulating this to the community. What?
You were talking.
Oh, okay, so I thought you were talking too. okay, so I do want to touch, I mean, no one wants to see the building be empty forever. No one wants to see it rot. No one wants to see that. It's special. It's a fabulous school building. But I personally have a hunch that you're going to need it again. And I won't support additions on other schools, and I'll try not to have a temper tantrum if that's proposed, but it'll be very difficult for me. Okay, so Clarksville sits on 12.4 acres. Sheriff, what are you planning on doing with 12.4 acres?
First of all, over half the property is really unusable. There's a field in the back, as I mentioned a couple of minutes ago. We want to build a garage, and then we also want to use the fields in the back for kids to come, use it for lacrosse, flag football, softball, whatever the case may be.
Okay. So how much would you need to build your facility?
Well, again, you know, we're really in the infant stages here. So it's we're thinking maybe 40 by 40, could be 50 by 50, could be 100 by 100. But it's the woods are primarily unusable.
Lumber is valuable.
Well, yeah, but it's also wetlands, and you're not going to touch wetlands.
Yes, we have a wonderful vernal pond back there. I used to love to get water samples and look under a microscope at those. They were fun.
Still use that.
Check yourself for ticks.
Sheriff, can you just correct that? The 40 by 40 that you're talking about is just an additional building, I think.
That would be a garage that we envision adding a garage onto the back of the parking lot, the existing parking lot, where there's a double gate that we push snow through now, that we would probably remove that back part. I mean, again, we're just kind of envisioning this,
right,
and the garage would be back there.
I think what she was asking is if you built a whole new separate building, left
Couldn't happen on those grounds. Okay. We actually have somebody that we've been working with.
I don't know. You've got a house right there. It's a wonderful house. Your neighbors have. There's a lot of houses there. I don't.
Ma'am, we don't
Judy.
Need a house. We need a huge building. We need like a minimum of.
Like the fire department built on the other side of 443. That's a wonderful building.
We need a 15,000 square foot building at a minimum. What those grounds would yield, I really couldn't say because we haven't tested them. There's no sewer out there, so we would have to add that. And just, again, just so I would make it clear, the school board didn't come to us. I know you're kind of aiming your anger at the school board. We went to them and asked them.
I'm not angry. I just want facts and logic.
We went to them and asked them to pursue this, that building needs a couple $1 million. And as you can see up there, they've already envisioned.
How does it need a couple $1 million if we just put $3.5 million into it a few years ago?
Well, according to the engineer's report, right off the bat, it needs $697,000 just in abatement.
What's abatement?
Asbestos.
No. They took all the asbestos out. I know that.
No, they did not. There's a lot of asbestos.
So your contractors, you might want to investigate them because I'm pretty sure they took the asbestos out.
We do a portion.
Well, because there was retesting. I remember that because I saw a hit and I called. I work in the environmental health field. I was like, okay, I see a number. We got
to keep. There's a lot that needs to come out. All right. So, I mean, the building needs a lot of work. And quite honestly, I don't know if I would want my kid going into that school today in its existing form. It needs a lot of work.
I don't know what else you have to add, Judy.
Are you shutting me down?
Well, I want to give other people an opportunity to speak as well. The one thing I did want to clarify is you had asked about the development slide and it didn't align with the Capital Region Planning Commission's report. That slide was updated from the town afterward when they looked at that and they provide us with additional detail on the amount of development. What's the realistic time frame
yes,
on that?
I have that too. I got that from Mr.
Okay.
Leslie and he said it wasn't inclusive of everything.
Okay, that's what he provided with us, so.
No, he said it didn't include everything. It was the bigger projects that, you know, but I don't think, I thought, I read 766 residential units coming online. All right, so I guess I've alluded to the idea that I really, really would like to see the school be a school someday. I feel like it might be necessary if you're, you know, go look at, there's a map on Town of Bethlehem's website, okay? Go look to see where all the development's gonna be happening. It doesn't just happen in the center of town. It happens in all different locations. And some of your schools are really full, really full. And you're gonna shift. You're gonna have to have a shift anyway. God bless you to go through that again. But you're gonna have to do some flexing. And I just don't know how, you know, you wanna cut your nose to spite your face. I mean, I don't know if you have a need for, you know, 150 kids that need to go somewhere, there's still a school building that can hold 150 kids. It's not a massive school building. I just want to finally say, I always hear you guys say that you're worried about a charter school if you put it on the market. I've been hearing that for years. I've heard different people say it, that if you sell it, you might get a charter school. Yes, I've heard that for years. And Tabano said it when we were talking about potentially closing Clarksville. We don't want to sell it. We don't want a charter school. Okay, it truly happened. I'm not imagining that. I just want to make sure we put that to bed. I really don't think that would be the case. My dream would be we give some acreage to Sheriff Apple, give him, because town gave property to you guys, you know, to make a school, to convince us to be part of the school, and let him build his, what suits his needs. This is my dream, okay? I know you're shooting me down on this, but this is my dream. And then we just make sure that we proceed carefully, because I am worried that you're gonna end up putting additions and Eagle can't build, yes. Slingerlands really has no room for, right? Okay, correct me if I'm wrong. Eagle, Slingerlands, and Ellesmere have no room to expand. No. Is that all correct?
Eagle, Glenmont, and Hamagrill all have room space.
Not existing rooms, if you needed to put an addition on, physical addition.
I don't know. We haven't done a study on that.
So on March 30th, 2011, there was a motion by Lynn Landhart, and it was seconded by somebody, maybe Jim Daring, for a district-wide enrollment study. I would really like to see you do that before there's a decision made. Because that motion was seconded, it was left on the table, the meeting was gaveled immediately, and everyone scrambled. But that still sits on your table. You don't have a table in front of you, but it's a little imaginary motion that's been there for 6 years.
The December 6th, well, the...
That's not the same. I mean, when you think about... Enrollment projections just carry a line. They're really simple. They don't look at everything going on, building. They don't look at, they do include live birth cohort, yes, for the entry. But after that, it just carries on a line. So if that line's going up, the math just carries that line forward. If the math is going down, the line just carries that line forward. That's just how that math works. Have Mr. Neff take a look at it. So I just really would like you to take care of making this decision, and that's all I'm going to say, but thank you.
Thank you.
So the last time I spoke at the board meeting, I was called a conspiracy theorist by Dr. Tabano because I mentioned the possible closing of Clarksville Elementary. And I, you know, we do have conspiracy theorists out in the woods out there. I didn't think I was one of them. However, guess what? You closed Clarksville, now you're selling it. I have a procedural question, and I have no objection to all of you folks, so welcome to Clarksville. Again, we've talked about this. Procedurally, if I want to sell my house, I generally put it on the market. So do you, you're not obligated, you know, like if you want to buy something, you have to put it out to bid. You don't have to do that. You can just shake hands and it's a deal.
What the appraisal process is for.
Okay.
So you have to reasonably determine what the market value is, and that's what the appraisal accomplishes.
All right, but so you don't have to, if somebody else came in and said, I want to give you $1 million, you don't have to entertain that.
Well, we would.
All right.
But I don't have that.
I'm a couple hundred thousand short, otherwise I would help you with that.
I mean, that might drive up the market value a little bit.
I'm done? All right, I have to sit down now? No. I had a question on, do you know if there have been any studies done on the impact of closing Clarksville on the property values in Clarksville? It's appealing if you live in town and you can walk your kids to school. It's not so appealing if the kids are taking a bus home for an hour. In Clarksville, the hour bus was the first bus out of the parking lot. So maybe that's a consideration for Eagle to look at. The kids who are going the farthest, their bus pulls out first. But has there been any kind of study done on that in terms of property values? Since it ultimately affects how much money you guys get. Yeah. It's okay if it's a no.
No formal studies. Again, it's still part of the Bethlehem School District.
Okay. And then Sheriff Apple, can we tap into your fiber optic line? Because...
Yeah.
As you know, we, you know, depending on where I am in my house, my cell phone doesn't even work. And I had this really nice gentleman from New Hampshire in my front yard for several days splicing your cable together. So if that's a consideration at all, that would be great. And also, if you could crank the sirens down a little bit as you zip through town. I don't know, I guess to end, I am disappointed with the board, with the exception of Mr. Fishbein, because I don't believe he was on it at the time this decision was made, and that's all I'm gonna say.
Just a point of clarification, I know the transportation issue is something that has been brought up. That's something we can address with our transportation director to see if there's any way to improve that. You know, part of it is just purely distance, but certainly that's something that we can have addressed through transportation. I mean, regardless of what happens.
Right. Thank you. Rusty Riley, Clarksville. I just want to make a clarification on when they did the bond issue, 2005, and the work that was done. In my previous life, I was a contractor. I pulled all the cable in the entire district, so I know the buildings intimately. Did not take all the asbestos out of all the buildings, just the classrooms. Sheriff's dead on. There's $600,000 worth of asbestos needs to come out of there. Everybody says, it was upgraded technology. Okay, has everybody here got a computer they've had since 2003? Yeah. Don't work real well, do they? This is 2016. I'm now
17.
I'm supervisor plant operations at St. Peter's. We have spent millions of dollars on upgrades in the last 5 years. Because what was good 5 years ago is no longer good now. So automation-wise, if you move back in that building, as far as state ed would be concerned, you'd have to upgrade the ventilation system, remove all the asbestos.
I'm sorry, I don't mean to interrupt you, but we are being recorded so that people can watch it later. So if you could just speak into the mic. Okay. I know it seems rude, but right, that's the only way it'll pick it up on the video.
I'm used to preaching. Sorry. Automation-wise, and to bring the building up to standard, I think your 900,000 is a little light, okay? And being a construction guy for 40 years, I hate to say this, because I know a lot of people love that building. It's cheaper to build a new classroom on one of your buildings than it would be to rebuild that. That's being realistic. That's what I do for a living. So, I'm sorry, I love the school and I love Clarksville, but all in all, it would probably cost you more to bring that back to where it needs to be than it would be to put an addition on one of your other buildings. So, thank you.
My name is Lynn Cable. I live in Clarksville. I do share a few concerns about the enrollment projections with Judy. Do we have any hard data, like based on some of the multi-unit buildings that we have in the district now and how many kids they actually contribute? I know you went to the town. I'm not really sure what they use to come up with that data.
In regards to the...
Like, say the mansions.
Right, so in regards to those existing, yes, we have actual student data, the number of students that we have enrolled currently and the amount that tend to turn over, which is obviously a little more in those housing units than others. In regards to the new developments, in speaking with the town, they talk to us about what is the market that they're appealing to, and that's how part of the enrollment projections are done, and what's the likelihood that a family with children will be moving into those. In some of the newer developments,
I know their target is for people
older,
downsizing,
right?
And things
but
like that.
we have that for current for the current houses that are multifamily.
Okay. I guess then most of my questions belong to the sheriff. As someone who, my parents live right next to the school, and so my kids are there a lot. There are actually quite a few kids right there in the neighborhood. I would like to see the grounds be a little more welcoming to the neighborhood kids. I'm not really sure that the playground has been well maintained. It's rotting, it's full of bees. The kids just don't go there anymore. You know, occasionally they're on the swings or whatever. I would like to see a commitment. You are in the Clarksville neighborhood, and I think it's great, all of the things that you're saying about all the things that you want to do for the Hilltowns, but you're in Clarksville. So I'd like to see a commitment from you to do something for the people who live in Clarksville, because that's where you are going to reside too. So, you know, you took over the basketball court, and at the time we were supposed to see the basketball court come back, and that didn't happen. You know, maybe your explorers could maintain the vernal pond. I think that those things are important, because when all in all of your talk of community, a lot of it belongs to the Hilltowns and not to Clarksville.
Well, I kind of take exception to that, honestly. We've done a lot in the Clarksville community, and first of all, the playground's not ours. That's carved out of our lease as well right now.
I'm not saying that you were responsible for maintaining it, but you will be going forward.
Absolutely, and that's what we want the kids to come. We want them to come, use your, you know, use, do AAU in the gymnasium, have your Boy Scout meetings, your Girl Scout meetings, absolutely. We have a lot of money that we have to put into that, but we want it to be community friendly, absolutely. That's our number one goal. We need to harden it up a little bit. Again, it's gonna be a police station. Right now, it's still, you could make it an elementary school relatively quickly, as far as its regular structure. But it needs a lot of money. So, you know, there's going to be plans, there's going to be phases and goals that we have to meet. But again, you know, we want the playground there. That we've committed to that day one, that we want the playground there. I don't use it, so I don't know what kind of condition it's in. But yes, we will definitely get it up to par.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Shannon Herrick. I live in Del Mar. First, I'd like to say, Judy Abbott, I love you. She's got the biggest heart. She's the most well-informed community member I know. So it feels like this is a done deal to me. And I'm not saying it's a bad done deal, just that it's a done deal. I think the battle was lost for the people of Clarksville when the school closed. So if we could think about ways to make it better for them. They lost their community school. They're not getting it back. My kids go to Hammer Grill. I know how awesome that is to have. And I would hate to lose that. So they also lost their PTA. I mean, they didn't have a need for it. And I remember at the time, they were trying to say, well, can we be incorporated in the schools that our kids are going to? How do we stay active? So what about forming like a PTO or a PTA to help make the decisions for the things in the school, like the totem pole or peace pole or the playground. I think the school district could make a commitment to, even if they sell it, to say to the town, we're going to put money in, we're going to help maintain that. Sorry, I always get so nervous, so. but I think also, you can't tell us where the number of kids are going to come from. There's lots of evidence that says it can go up or down. What about a commitment from the school board that says, for the whole district, we're going to cap classroom sizes no matter what happens. We're not going to make future, you know, classroom sizes huge to deal with this decision that we shouldn't have made to begin with, but we have to deal with. Before the sale is made, get some feedback from the community, but also commitments from you that will address all those issues moving forward. I think math and science classes, specifically in the middle school, already need to be dealt with. But you know, I had kids in Hammer Grill. My one daughter, she had 30 kids in her classroom one time. So I think you could make other commitments to the community, since this is a done deal, in my opinion, to benefit the decision that's been made on our behalf. Along those lines. Thank you.
Hi, I'm a little shorter than Judy. I'm Tanya Choppy. I live on Stovepipe Road, and I will attest to Judy's claim that not everybody knew about this meeting if they weren't connected to SNN. I live in a Voorheesville zip code. I received no mail, just the SNN. Thankfully, I still have kids in the school district, so I'm still connected to that. When you decided to close Clarksville, my heart was broken. It really was. I have, in my family, four generations that went to that school. And I do feel that this is already a done deal, and you're just kind of dotting your I's and crossing your T's. Taking the emotion out of it, it probably is for the best, but I hate it.
Hi, I'm Christy Narang. I live in Clarksville on Graceland. So this is more just kind of a general comment that, and sort of a question for the future. I mean, we definitely already have increased traffic volume and more cars, more people coming by, more people even drive down our driveway and turn around because I guess they think it's a road. So I guess I'm just wondering, you know, if you're bringing more services and people for the future, if there are some plans that are going to change either for, I don't know what kind of traffic changes you can make, but for parking or other things like that. I mean, I don't know how many people run that stop sign when they're coming to show up for traffic court. I mean, come on. So, I mean, these are just things that we think may increase with the future. So it's a concern that we have living in the area. So
we've two things quickly. This is far from a done deal. I know everyone mentions that it's far from that. I mean, but at the end of the day, we may not be able to afford it with the money that needs to go in it. But we kind of concurred that this was the right thing to do as far as to get the message out and let people come out and state their piece on it. As you can see, some are for it, some against it, some really just kind of listening. But we would have to do a whole study out there. I mean, again, we may end up with a smaller garage. I didn't know that the basketball court was gone, but I guess it's still there. It's just trapped inside our fence, so nobody can use it.
Right.
So yeah, we've got some things that we want to address. We really wanted to increase the parking all along, but again, we didn't own it, and we can't keep tearing up lawn. We tried to make some changes early on, because I know when Scotland Court was in session, they were parking all over the place, and it was turning into a nightmare. And that's something we had to work out with New Scotland, and it's kind of under control. But again, we're trying to deal with just the grounds that we have. So we've got to do some expansions, but I can assure you, if this goes through, when we're done with it, I want it to be pretty much like a community resource center, not just the sheriff's public safety building. And we want people to be able to come in and use the building. We want to be able to, you know, be good neighbors and have everybody come in. And hopefully, I think we've certainly made the community safer since we've been there. And as far as your fiber goes, I will tell you that our radio system, when it comes online, would be flooding the area with broadband, wireless broadband. So just kind of hold tight on that if you
want to protect your
network. Really bad problem. But, so yes, we would definitely consider that. I mean, we will be sitting down with engineers and architects and go, okay, what can we do here to, you know, keep, we want that building to stay. Basically, it's the way it is now. We just got to clean it up. But the grounds are going to need some shifting for us. But we're open to keeping everything that's there. We would like to see stay there. We're actually going to be bringing out from another building that we have an area where people can come and sit and just kind of meditate and pray, because it basically pertains to car accidents and DWIs and loss of life. And some people just go there and they sit and they meditate. And in the back area there, it would be beautiful for that. So, I mean, we have a vision. Whether it comes, you know, to fruition or not on those grounds is yet to be seen. But again, this is far from a done deal. And I just thought, you know, and Jody agreed that we should really just kind of get it out there and see what the public thinks about it. And we said 60 months ago that we want to be good neighbors. We don't want anybody upset that we're there. I know we had an issue with a neighbor when we first moved in there. They didn't want us, you know, they parking was a nightmare, and he couldn't move his trucks, and we tried to work with him, and I think we got that straightened out. And but since we've been out there, things have been pretty good. And we're just looking to stay.
My name is Rob Breen. I am a resident of Clarksville. My wife and I, we bought our first home and started raising our family. We moved to Clarksville so we could send our kids there. And just in time for our kids to start school, the school closed. So we have five young kids where we did not want to put our kids on a bus. So we've chosen to homeschool for now. And we'll look at a variety of options. I want to say this is how democracy unfolds. This is unfortunate for us, but this is a democracy. People moved in that direction, and we accept that. So one of the things that I would like to consider, however, is that it's just a great resource and an asset for the community. So if we move forward on doing something like this, maybe one of the things that can happen is we create an ad hoc committee to take a look at a variety of different options. So for example, if the possibility is getting other entities to come in to use the facilities, they would pay rental fees, so why couldn't the school district possibly, maybe for the first few years, take a look at renting out the facility and bringing in some revenue for a time and see if that's going to work, probably changing the lease so that some more permanent things can happen to support the sheriff. But a team that actually could come together, an ad hoc team just to take that gets authorized and people could volunteer with their expertise and take a look at maybe three or four or five different options. You know, maybe it's great to use the school as partly as an education center again. Maybe BOCES can come in. Maybe Voorheesville is going to expand and they need it for special programs. Maybe the district could look at it as a special place to do different types of after-school education programs or special types of schools. I'd spent some time in northern Arizona doing grad work, and the school district recognized that some alternative programs might fit the needs of certain students. So what if there was a agricultural, special kind of curriculum and there's a special program that could be operated out of there. But if a team were put together, an ad hoc team, just take a look at some options, look at some costs, look at a variety of different choices, bring it back to the community, people can take a look at it, we can dialogue and have a discussion and make this a real, real community decision for the best choice as opposed to one choice, yes or no. So.
My name is Karen Riley. I grew up in Clarksville. I went to Bethlehem Central. Well, many generations of my family went to Clarksville. But I just have to say that I feel, from living out there and going to Bethlehem, I think Clarksville was forgotten in the whole transition of closing the school, and then when the sheriffs came in. I think if this does happen that they sell a school, Bethlehem needs to come and accommodate Clarksville a little bit. These kids riding an hour to school when they're in kindergarten is ridiculous, but nobody looks at the transportation part of it. We are taxpayers too. We pay a lot of money for school taxes as well here, and I think that the board and the transportation and the superintendent, everybody should look and incorporate Clarksville back into the Bethlehem Central School District. We're kind of a forgotten entity out there. And I just felt for years it's unfair. And when this happened, Clarksville did suffer. We do have families moving out there. There are houses that are selling, and there are kids coming into the community. But these, it's a hard sell for out there when people find out from other people that the kids have to ride so long to go to school. We're not incorporated in this Bethlehem Central School District, which we've been in the school district for numerous years. So I would like to see the board to consider Clarksville a little bit more than they do, because we are a big part of it. And there are families out there with kids. I mean, we are spread out, but there is a number of people buying out there. I know there's a house across the street from me that's going to sell. I don't know if there's children coming in or not, but if they are, I watch these kids get on the bus all the time, and that ride is ridiculous. And I want to say I'm happy in a lot of ways that the sheriffs are out there. I think we've had a lot of changes. I know the school does need a lot of work, and I'd like to see more community events there as well. If the sheriffs do buy it, I think it would be a great thing for Clarksville, and hopefully we could all come together as one unity group for both the school district and the sheriff's patrol.
Hi. I'm sorry, I know it's my second time up, but I just do want to address one thing about the communication that different people have said, and I know I heard about the meeting while I was eating dinner on the news. I live in the 12186 zip code, and my kids are long out of school. So I do encourage that when you are sending something out, that you please do send a mailing or something, because I'm sure, like they said, most people weren't aware of this meeting. Thank you.
Get up and sit down again. My name is Mary Van Alstein. I've lived in Clarksville since I was 10 years old. My youngest brother started school there. I went to school, the little two-room schoolhouse up on the hill, which there was first, second, and third in one room, fourth, fifth, and sixth in the other. It was a good school. Then we got the Clarksville school. I was down in the high school. My youngest brother started school there. My son, my grandchildren, my oldest granddaughter, when she was training to be a teacher, her student teaching was done in the Clarksville grade school. It was a beautiful school. To me, it should stay there as it is, but it is, for the sheriffs to come in, I think is a good idea. We need them, but there's no way I would like to see that school go to rack and ruin and have it fall apart. You gotta have somebody in there all the time to keep it up. And I would suggest the Clarksville school logo, the thing there, to be put in a rock or something right on that property as a remembrance for all the people there in Clarksville. That was our school. And I think it belongs there, not in Slingerland's or Del Mar or any other place. And a long time ago, Clarksville was Del Mar. But that's something a lot of people don't, you gotta go into history on that.
I just wanted to say thank you very much to these guys who came out and gave up their evening with their families. I think that if the school was to be sold, Clarksville couldn't get a better neighbor. I think overall, your commitment is incredible, and the resources that you want to bring to that community, to our community, is commendable. And what I would like to say to our school board is I feel very frustrated that we're in this place. I'm hearing a lot of frustration, even from people who want to sell the building, because Clarksville is part of our community, and we did not do right by those families. We didn't. And if in selling this school, the objective is, I don't understand what exactly the objective is other than to keep it an occupied place. And like I said, we couldn't ask for a better tenant. I mean, that's, you know, you're not gonna find someone else that has that level of commitment. You know, as much as we could get revenue from renters, I don't think that the level of commitment would be the same to the community. I'm just not clear what our district gains in terms of what we offer to the families in Clarksville, in terms of how we handle future growth, because we would like to be able to grow, I think. And, you know, we have six empty classrooms in our district, and I think overall that's enough to accommodate some flexibility. But what happens if? Are you guys gonna build another school? Are you gonna build a school out in Clarksville? Like, I would, you know, I think some answers to those kind of questions to address the needs of the community that got left behind would be appropriate. That's all.
Hey again.
So, oh.
Greetings. My name is Renee Fischetti. I am the vice president of PTO at the middle school. I'm happy to be here in front of you. I have two children in the middle school. They are both honor students, and they went to Clarksville, and they had a really great time at that school. Thank you to everybody who's come tonight. Quick couple questions. The first one is to the sheriff's station, and I'm wondering, I've asked this question to a lot of friends about what your patrol area is, and nobody really knows what the answer to that question is. I mean, do you feel that Clarksville is central to your patrol area because you do service the hill towns? Or, I mean, is Albany more of a central area for you guys to come out of and service?
If you look at the map, Boersville is like the nucleus of Albany County.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're just outside of that. But a lot of our functions at the Clarksville station, the old Boersville station, are not just patrol. We have emergency managements out there. So to answer your question, our primary patrol zone is everything outside of the town of Bethlehem, town of Gilderland that do not have patrol capabilities themselves. We patrol those zones for them, and then we'll augment others as necessary. So it's a perfect hub for our patrol zones. It's also a good hub for the emergency management, because we're outside of what would be critical infrastructure, downtown Albany, things of that nature. So this area does suit us in more ways than just patrol.
Right.
We do have a station downtown as well.
Right, but I didn't know if there was like overlap, like if you went down to Menands or East Greenbush or any of those areas.
The farthest part of the county would be down in Cooksburg, down in Rensselaerville area.
Uh-huh.
So if anywhere farther, like north, northeast for us, we would have to get into adding manpower to have overlapping shifts, because to be able to respond from Clarksville to Cooksburg right now takes quite a bit of time as it is. So anywhere further, we would just really be adding on the time. So we would have to have overlapping shifts. So this area, this general vicinity really does suit us.
Thank you. So I noticed that the town of New Scotland has some presence there.
Yes.
I did an audit for town of New Scotland and surveyed the premises. So do we know what's going to happen to the town court or the clerk's office if the building is sold? They will stay. Okay. One further question. If the building is going to be sold, is there going to be any clause in the sale agreement or a deed restriction put in place that the property cannot be subdivided? I'd hate to see that we sell something like the school to the sheriff department, and then within 2 or 3 years he subdivides and sells off 4 lots for residential housing. So is that a thought that anybody has given to the sale?
Not yet. No. But again, that's what we're hoping to get this kind of feedback for. So mm-hmm. I'm keeping a list. And if we get to that point, we can consider.
Okay. Thank you.
Survey of the children up there, because I attended a pancake breakfast, and there's kids everywhere. There's a lot of kids. Just make sure you're not making a mistake.
We have that whole demographic study. We know where our enrollment is and whatnot.
But
I'd like to. I'd like to.
The same mistake again.
I'd like to thank the community for coming out, and especially the Clarksville residents. I know we made a concerted effort to reach out more than we ever have before, and. In any other meeting, we always usually just advertise it on an SNN. We did make an effort to reach out. Obviously, it wasn't the best of effort we could have done. Sorry for that. But we did do more than we've ever done in the past. Oh, yeah. And board members have toured out to the facility and seen what a great use the sheriff is doing with that. My children attended Clarksville, too. It's very dear and near to me. Actually, when I was touring out there, many memories rushed back about Mrs. Appleby being there, Bonnie O'Shea, Mrs. Barb Regal, Mary Pat Remmel, a great school. It really was a great school. And it was a very difficult decision for the board to make when they made it, to close it. It was not done lightly. It wasn't an easy decision, but we made that decision. And now we have another decision ahead of us, and we'll continue that. I'd like to thank again everyone for coming out, expressing your opinions, and being very respectful tonight to everybody. So thank you.
If anyone does have further questions or comments, or you leave here and you think, I really should have asked that, you can always call my office or email if that's more convenient, or whatever's easiest. And I know Sheriff Apple would take any further questions that you have as well. So thanks again for coming out. Again, as Mr. Downey said, my apologies if people did not receive notification. We really did try to get the word out through the Spotlight, the Times Union, the news, letters, SNNs, but sometimes we miss things. So our apologies, thanks again, and have a great evening.